I'd like to now maybe move on and invite maybe Manwai first to offer his thoughts on the discussions thus far.
Okay, thanks, Kevin. Maybe I will share some experience that I have in Japan with regards to the future, looking at the future economy of Singapore. And a lot of areas are quite relevant, I think. One is, you know, in Japan, during the heydays, when they were very successful, when I was there like in the 1980s or that, they were all talking about how great the industrial policy bureaucrats in Japan are, okay? But on hindsight, actually they missed out on all the digitalization, you know, that comes in the late 90s and all that. So I think, first of all, when we try to explore what should be the direction going forward, I think we have to understand that the world today is very diverse, even with the disruptive technology. Just like I heard a lot of the panelists, with all due respect, sitting there trying to forecast what should be the industries that Singapore should participate in, you know, I think that is exactly something we should avoid. Okay, we can forecast some of these industries and have bear that in mind, but allowing the government to try to push those industries, I think is something that we have to bear in mind that it is something that we may want to avoid, lah. Okay. The next thing about the Japanese experience is that they were so reliant on their property market, okay, in the course of their high growth period. So, and because of the collapse of the property in the 1990s, they were still basically licking their wounds even up to today, okay, because of the high leverage and the real estate, the property market in the 1990s at the peak, basically had cream off many generations of values out of the economy already. Of course, we can talk about the property being a very important or very effective economy tool, okay, management tool, but that is, in the case of Japan, they really have overused it. And I think our country, and to a very large extent, the whole of Asia, actually is running into the danger now that we are relying too much on the property market to boost the economy. Okay, and the third thing about the Japanese experience that we have to bear in mind is that all the things that many people are talking today about stakeholder capitalism, about in Japan, in those days, they talk about corporate capitalism, which is more or less the same thing, because the corporate capitalism that the Japanese talk about, they say Hojin Shihon Shugi, okay, corporate capitalism. Actually, what they mean is that social responsibility of the companies, the corporate sector, which includes the responsibility to the workers, responsibility to the suppliers, responsibility to the community. And of course, first of all, customer first spirit, you know. So all these about actual stakeholder is the same concept. What I'm trying to, and then they also have the lifetime employment thing, you know, and all that. And I mean, I was studying in Japan in the early 80s. Even then, I was thinking, all these things may not be the drivers. They are just the results of a competitive economy. So going forward, what I want to say is that we bear in mind that we need stakeholder interest, we must put that interest at heart and all that, but they are not the drivers of a economic model going forward, okay? So in Japan, we had that already many years ago. They have discussed that, you know, and all that, you know, and what happens in Japan is that despite the deflation they have experienced over the last three decades, there is a core technology sector comprising many of the smaller companies. We all know by now that all the big Japanese companies have fallen out one after another. Hitachi, Toshiba, Sony, everybody just got knocked out of the world competition. Okay, but a core group of technology companies that were previously suppliers and manufacturing for the big companies are still surviving. And Japan exports today, for example, the trade surplus with China is very much due to the supply of all these very crucial components to the Chinese and even to the Korean economy. So they do have a core group of they do have a core technology sector in Japan. But nevertheless, the Japanese economy still failed to ride the digitalization wave. Why is that so? Because the whole economy, in my opinion, is still stuck in an old mode. You know, it doesn't pay enough attention or give enough leeway to private enterprise in Japan, because the whole system is still very much led by the central government. A lot of things are still very stifling. You know, that's why the key word going forward about the Japanese economy is not about some new industrial policy or whatever. It is about deregulation. And deregulation means allowing the private sector to take the lead. So that may be something that we have to think about, even for the case of our country. Yeah, I'll leave it at that for the moment. Yeah.